Good evening. Our guest speaker this evening is Dr. Bernard Meisner. He's been past president of Mid-Cities Genealogical Society. He's currently currently secretary, parliamentarian, and webmaster for that organization. They run their affairs like we do, I guess. Dr. Meisner has, in his real life, been acting chief of science and technology services, the services division of the National Weather Service. And he's probably responsible for what we ended up walking into the library this evening for. Dr. Meisner, would you come and talk to us about mining the gems of the Civil War pension?
Sure. Thank you. I just retired recently from National Weather Service after about a 40-some year career, and it was really interesting to see it. It really, in the time I was there, changed from an art to a science. That now that people actually, pay attention to the predictions and make decisions based on the forecast rather than waiting for the weather to actually start before they do something. So it was a very interesting career that I enjoyed very much. And now this is sort of my new career. I've been giving a number of talks to my Mid-Cities group and decided, well, I could sort of shop them around to other genealogical societies as well and sort of share things that I've learned in the course of doing my research and often pointing out mistakes I've made so that you don't necessarily have to make them. And tonight, because we're sort of recognizing this was the week of Memorial Day, or even used to be called Decoration Day, and the origins of that really do go to the Civil War. So we thought it would be sort of appropriate to talk a bit about Civil War, and particularly in terms of genealogists, we're interested a lot in the pension files, because there's a lot of information in there that is of particular interest to genealogists. And as we mentioned, there's a handout in the back that has a lot of the details, lots of the web links, so you don't have to worry about frantically trying to write any of that down while I'm up here talking. So just a basic timeline, it sort of started while the war was even sort of ongoing. In 1862, they decided they wanted to at least provide pensions for those soldiers who had suffered war-related disabilities, or the widows and orphans of those soldiers who were killed in the war. So these were directly war-related injuries or casualties. By 1890, the government at that point actually had a good bit of money to start handing out, and with the hope of then getting some votes as well. So they sort of expanded it to anybody who served for at least 90 days. And when the war first started, people just signed up for 90 days because they thought it was going to be over so quick. And in fact, at the first battle of Manassas, there were some of the volunteers from New York, I was just reading recently, and were saying, this is our 90th day. We're not going there to get shot at. We're done. We're out of here. But that was the minimum, and then later on, of course, they signed up for longer times, then there was even a draft. But they decided by 1890 then anyone who was a veteran who had served for at least 90 days, and these are Union veterans, to the victors go the spoils, and any disability, even if it wasn't war-related, they could still be eligible for a pension. And then come 1907, they decide, well, just being old is a disability. Now, we may disagree with that to some extent, but again, it was a good way to sort of hand out money and get votes for folks. So by 1907, anybody who was over 62 didn't even have to have any physical disability. They were eligible for a pension. Finally, in 1930, they decided the federal government would give a pension to Confederate veterans. Prior to that, the pensions for the Confederate veterans were given by the state in which they resided, not the state they were necessarily from, but where they were living at the time they wanted to apply for the pension. And usually in those cases, they had to show they really, really, really needed a pension and were just about destitute. And they usually asked them then to list what are those few things you own, which again, to us as genealogists, is something of particular interest. And you'll notice I have lots of links in addition to a page in the handout at the bottom of the slides as well. In 1958, remember 1930 is when they decided they would give pensions to the Confederate veterans. Well, 1958, he collected for 28 years. The last Confederate veteran passed away. It was in 1956, the last Union pensioner. He was getting a whole $135.45. But again, that was in 1956 when things were a lot less expensive. The last known Union widow was Gertrude Janeway. She died in 2003. Now, she and her husband were very good. They waited till she was 18. They waited 3 years after they met, waited till she was 18 to get married. Of course, he was 81, so the inducement was marry me and you'll get a pension. And she said, okay. And we actually, as best I can tell, there is still one child of a Civil War veteran still collecting a benefit. She was born about 1930, and she's in a home, obviously, and has been all her life. Another was a man who just died in the last year. There used to be two of them. So all in all, about 2.8 million men and a few hundred women, particularly as nurses, served in the armies. If you're thinking of, do you have a ancestor or two or three or more that maybe served and would be applying for a pension, usually it was typically people born from about 1811 to 1848, although we know some guys lied about their age and went in when they were even a little bit younger than that. The widows had to prove, in fact, they were married to that soldier. So then, of course, that's some good genealogical records you had to look for. And the minor children had to supply proof not only were they the children of the soldier, but their mother was the wife of the soldier as well. So if you come across those, there'll be even additional information. We'll point out at the bottom there, this is for people that were in the Union Army or Navy. If they were in a state militia, then they were not eligible for a Union pension, and they'd have to rely on their particular state. This is even if they were on the Union side. So you need to pay attention a little to, you know, how did your ancestor serve? Okay, what's in the application? Name, rank, serial number, of course. They didn't have serial numbers back then, but unit, when they served, where they were when they applied, about where were they born, and again, particularly on more of the Confederate side, where they were looking to see were you destitute, what property did you have? And you know, maybe you had a wheelbarrow, and that would have been about it, or something. The widow, of course, had to prove that she, in fact, was married to the soldier who died, so had to have proof of that, and she couldn't have remarried. If she remarried, she was no longer eligible for a pension. And then, of course, the children had to include not only all the information that the widow provided, but also where they were born, when they were born, and they had to be under 16 at the time they were applying for the pension. So lots of good information in those records. And the thing you want to pay attention to are the magic numbers, the certificate numbers. And I'll point out there at the bottom, the one that really matters is the last one issued. So you'd start with a soldier applying, assuming he's still alive. And they would have first signed a number that would be coded as the survivor's original, the SO. And not everybody applied got a pension, but they do have the records of the applications. If, in fact, they decide they deserve the pension, then they would get a soldier certificate and get another number, and all the paperwork would be moved over to that file. If a widow applied, either because the soldier was killed during the war or died at some time afterwards, then she would apply a new number, the widow's original number would be assigned. And if they decide she deserved the pension, then it would be a widow's certificate. And they have a similar thing for minor's original, minor's certificates. The key thing is, what's the last number? Essentially, these records are filed under the last number. So that's the one you want to pay attention to. Now, around 1900 or so, they decided, gee, every time we do one of these, we have to pick up the file, move it, file it someplace else. This is a lot of moving stuff around. We're going to switch, and if we still have active soldiers, they get a C number, and the widows and dependents get an XC number. And those will appear, I'll show you examples of them where they apply, because they weren't, there wasn't a place for them on the original form, because they didn't think they were going to do that. And now they just store them all together by those certificate numbers, so they weren't moving the files around anymore. Now, if there was still a claim around about 1928 or so, when the Veterans Administration was formed, and then they gave the records to the National Archives, they still held on to the active files, and they still have them. There's negotiations going on to gradually sort of transition all these. As I point out, there's only one live pensioner probably left that's collecting. But the Veterans Affairs still have those. And if that's the case, then you're going to have to write to them using the Freedom of Information Act. And I've got the verbiage. It's in the handout as well. And you can find it online. And I'll show you an example of one of those I encountered. So, first thing you want to ask is, do I have a Civil War soldier that I want to look for? The Park Service had started, I forget how many years ago I first heard this. Their idea was, anytime you came into a national park, there'd be a kiosk there. And anybody could go to the kiosk, enter a name to look and see, did in fact they have a Civil War soldier in their family. So they had started with some additional partners putting together this general index cards, compiling all of them. It's just some basic information. It's just the indices of the records, but it's from both sides, the Union and the Confederate, from all the states and territories. So they were sort of, they've been trying to get sort of anybody who was a soldier, in theory, would be in this database. In 1890, you may be familiar, they did do a veteran census schedule, but unfortunately, before it got turned over to the archives, about half of it burned. It's basically A through the first part of Kentucky. So, but if you're lucky enough, my ancestors are from Pennsylvania, P is between Kentucky and Wyoming in the alphabet, so I was able to get a copy of that 1890 veteran census. So it depends on what states they were in. Half of the states sort of burned, the others are there. And this is an example of what one of those documents looked like. So as they were doing the 1890 census, and we know the whole 1890 census has its own history as well, when they came across somebody and said, were you a veteran of the Civil War? And the person said, yes, they pulled out this other slip of paper. And here you can sort of zoom in. Here's a John Fierst, who's one of my relatives. And he was a private in Company L of the 5th Regiment of the Pennsylvania Heavy Artillery. And when he enlisted and when he got out, and down at the bottom of the form, they have what his current address was. So if you hadn't found the address any other way. So the latter half of Kentucky through Wyoming, anybody who was in those states. So Kentucky, it's going to be a coin toss, but the other states later in the alphabet, Massachusetts and the like, would have this census record. Now, the Senate in 1882 sort of decided, who all is getting pension records? We want a list. We want to know. we want to do a report, form a committee, generate a report. That's what government does, right? So they went through and did a pension roll. It was in five volumes. It's there on Google Books, and it's in Ancestry. This is probably going to be your document of last resort. It does have some basic information, but let me show you an example of it here. Here we are from Pennsylvania, Allegheny County, and you look at the record, it's not by certificate number, it's not by name, anything, it's just by the counties. So you almost sort of have to go through page by page by page to get information. And again, what you'd really be looking for is this column on the left, the certificate number. It does have some interesting information about gunshot wounds, left leg, injury to abdomen or the like, widows or so on. But this would be sort of your last resort because of the fact there's no index, it's not in any order other than the geographical one. I added this one in, and this came out this week, and particularly for folks interested in the Confederate soldiers' family search, their landing page for the Civil War. They've posted this up, reminding everybody there's free access. But they have an addition there at the top, the Civil War Soldiers Index, but also for all the Confederate states. So if you have somebody from Texas, there's one of the links, one of the free databases they have that you can look for. And again, this is one URL I don't have in the handout. But again, you go to Family Search, look for Civil War, it should pop up. Okay, so now you want to look for that pension file, deciding maybe you have somebody there. If you're really, really, really lucky, and your ancestor was one of the first to apply for a pension, Fold 3 is actually putting the pension files online. All the rest of them aren't there yet. They have a goal of doing all of them. They've done about 5% so far, and it's going to take years and years and years because there's so many of them. They've never been filmed, digitized, or whatever, so they're using the actual paper records, which are all different shapes and sizes that they have to manually put on the camera, take a picture, the next page, the next page. The average file has about 140 pages in it, so this is a long and tedious process, but they're working towards it. So here's the starting point with just the index cards, which they have everybody of these, but basically that's all it is. It's just the first cover page. We'll have, again, there's my John Fierce, Company L, the 5th Pennsylvania Heavy Artillery, went in a private, out of private. That database, that's all they have. For, like I say, it's a limited number, and they'll have all this. There's also the general index to the pension files that both Ancestry and Family Search has most of the index cards. And again, this will give you the certificate numbers. There's a few that were considered too dark to film. They were primarily of Navy pensioners. And this is an example of one of those. And again, shows you the basic information you have. There's the soldier's name. There's my John Fierst. And there's the widow, Barbara. Again, shows the service information, does not have the rank in this particular case, sometimes it would. Shows the dates of filing. He filed first as an invalid, did that in 1897. There you see then the type of pension, there's invalid or the widow, or it would be the minor. And there's the numbers. Again, when he applied, he got his soldier's original number, and you can see that was 1,188,467. By 1897, a lot of people were applying for pensions. Yes?
About what year were those index cards done?
I'm not sure. Let's see, it has some widows on there. I'd have to go back and look.
But for the, generally for the 1812 Confederate, that
little
card was done by a copier
who went in. Right. This is a person went through the file, extracted that information from the record, sort of found it in, again, there's the certificate numbers, and there's that magic last number. That's where it's now filed.
The Works Progress Administration is what took those.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And there's two different sets, because I'll show you another set that looks very similar that they did. But yeah, they went through, so it was already to the point that she had had her certificate. That's where they found all the information extracted from that, those other certificate numbers, and all the rest of the information. So yeah, that would probably been in the 1930s or thereabout. Here are examples where they've put down at the bottom. Remember, once they got to about the 1900s, they decided, we don't want to keep moving these files around. So if it's an active soldier, it got a C number. And if it was a widow or a minor, it would get the XC number. And again, those were the ones that were still active at the turn of the century, and some of those continued on even to 1928 and beyond. But that's where you would look. And again, if you see that, that's the magic number you want to look for. That's where it's filed. All the other numbers are sort of irrelevant. That's where it used to be filed. But where is it now? It's the last number assigned to it. Okay, there's also on fold three, the organizational index to pension files of veterans. These are, again, mainly Civil War, but she mentioned there are some other wars from like 1812 you may find in there as well. Grouped by the units, and the cards, again, look very similar. But again, this is a separate card, same guy, John Fierce. They didn't copy down the enlisted discharge dates, and then done about the same time. It does sort of point out, you can see the double dates for the invalid. The one is 1897, and then he came back 1907. Remember, after 1907, being 62 was a disability, and he reapplied for that. And that's when he got his, and that's why it says age. There's also the payment cards. The government keeps track of everything that you can actually go through, and as they paid him, it used to be a couple times a month, and then later they went to once a month, they had a record that you can find on Family Search. About 80% of them are on there now. Recommend use Internet Explorer, and when you search and find, then start going back and forth a little bit. You always do that in genealogy, right? When you find somebody, you always start looking around. I have a couple other good examples, one of my other talks, about where these folks are. They're buried right next to my great-great-grandparents. Barbara, John's wife, is the daughter. They're buried right next to them. And the first time I went to the cemetery, I didn't see them at all. And I didn't bother to take pictures of the adjacent grave sites. Fortunately, I went back again, and then said, oops, look at this. Okay, it will have his date of death in there as well. And then in the case of his wife, there's the widow, and where she went through and was getting her payments, some of them are up to $30, $36 a month. It wasn't a whole lot of money, but there was some. And then this continued on as the widow, they switched to the monthly payments, which is what you have there on the right. And then we have finally, she died in 1926. I found this recently, came across, this is for my cousin's family, National Homes for the Disabled Volunteer Soldiers. They established these, and the soldiers could go there. The big central one was in Dayton, Ohio. He was at one in Mountain Home in Tennessee, and he was there for a while. And found this was an interesting record. It's the only place I found anywhere it mentioned he had a gunshot wound to his neck. And none of the other records I've got so far did I find that. And like I say, these can be of interest. Again, they'll tell him when he served, who his wife was, where the wife is living. He was transferred to the central branch. He was in Tennessee and then went back to Pennsylvania, where he eventually died. But it has the military history, the domestic history. This only lists the last wife. This is wife number two. Wife number one didn't show up in the record. But when she would apply to get her widow's pension after he dies, she has to first prove the first wife is dead, and then that she married him. Because only one widow gets a pension, no matter how many wives you had. So there's some of his home history, and it's interesting, shows his pension. He was getting $12 a month, but also it was one more place to get that certificate number. Okay, so now you've got a certificate number, you really want to go look for the actual records. Okay, like I say, if you're really, 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 really lucky, Fold 3, working with the archives, is digitizing them. And they decide to go ahead and digitize the widow's pensions, which also includes the minor children. But if it was a soldier just by himself, they are not digitizing those, because it would not have too much information. It would just have the information about the soldier, but not the rest of the family. So they're gradually doing this. Again, it's going to take them years and years and years to do it. Otherwise, they're not on the internet anywhere. The actual files are back with the archives. So you have to go to the archives yourself, or you can order a copy, or you can pay somebody in Washington, D.C. to go to the archives and go get the information for you. So again, as I said, the archives in Fold 3 are digitizing them. They're gradually working through, because they've never been microfilmed. It's page by page, and believe me, they're all different shapes and sizes of documents when you get one of these. As of last month, they were up to the widow's certificate, 135,029. So they weren't even into the half a million, let alone a million or so. You can watch their progress at Fold 3, and if you want to search on Fold 3 form, that's how you present the number, not just the number itself, but the WC would be most likely what be, it might be MC for a minor child. Okay, otherwise you can write away to the archives and request the whole file, which now costs $80 for the first 100 pages and 70 cents a page after that. And most folks recommend, if you can afford it, that's what you want to do. They do have a discounted one, the document packet, which for $30, they'll give you up to these eight, but only these eight, nothing else that's in there. And there's probably a lot of other interesting stuff in there. So if you can afford the extra $50, then you can ask for that. And then they will go through, make copies, and send them to you. And they can now make and provide electronic copies or paper copies. This is the form you fill out. It's available online. And again, the recommendation is, if you found that index card with that certificate number, include that with the request, because it makes it a lot easier for them to find it, because it's filed by the certificate number. Again, what you'll find in there, the discharge papers, all sorts of affidavits, depositions, what happened to them, again, the marriage certificates, birth, death certificates. But it's not just the numbers and the beans that some people, genealogists, like to count. It really tells a lot about the soldier and his family, that information you probably are really interested in having. So here's just an extract of some examples from my great-granduncle John, and you've seen a bit. This is his actual application he submitted, and there's the soldier application number at the top. That's what he first sent in. And there's the form you filled out. You would either go to a notary public, a justice of the peace, perhaps you could use an attorney. So there was a side business that sort of went up with this, all the attorneys making money helping people file for these things. State of Pennsylvania, the 5th of August, 1902, he's before the alderman, he's John Fierce, 57, in Pittsburgh, Allegheny County, Pennsylvania. Trivia people knows there's no H on the end of the Pittsburgh. From 1880 to 1913, the government took it away, and then they got it back. So, whole other story. There's John Fierce. He enlisted the 24th August, 1864. There's that Company L, 5th Regiment, Pennsylvania Heavy Artillery. He was discharged in Vienna, Virginia on the 30th of June, 1865. He hasn't been employed by the military since. He hasn't filed before. And again, as you keep track of the regiments, the companies, the units they were in, there's probably somebody somewhere on the internet that is a fan of whatever that unit might be, and you can Google and find a lot of the history of that particular unit. In this case, they were formed in Pittsburgh. They went down to guard the nation's capital. They went over to Manassas in 1865, buried some soldiers. And I'm not sure if that was from a skirmish, because the battles of Manassas were 1861, 1862. And if they're showing up in 1865 to bury people. They lost 40-some people from the unit, and only three were lost to enemy action. All the rest were lost to disease. So that was sort of the way it was. Hasn't been there. Hasn't applied before. There he is in the state of Pennsylvania. He's got witnesses, Thomas Fierce, which is a brother, and Thomas Besode, who was in the army with him. Usually you needed somebody else to say, yeah, he was with me, because they didn't have the best of record keeping. There were a lot of records around, but to keep track in the application. And then here's Thomas saying, in fact, yes, I do know him. I've known him for so many years. The other people would say, yes, he fought in the war. Yes, I knew he was injured or the like. Those are the things you wouldn't get for the $30, but you could get for the $80. So then after he applied, they sent him this form, said, please fill this out, send it back. And they're anticipating at some point there may be an application for widows or minors. And for us, for genealogists, you married? When'd you get married? Where'd you get married? Who married you? Do you have a record of that? Were you married before? You have any children still alive? Who were they? When were they born? So lots and lots of great gems of information that you can find in these files. And then, like I say, you can find, if you're doing for disabilities, they had a report to the doctor. Often they'd have to come back. There's a number of these forms in his file that went through. He had a hernia that he got by lifting a heavy object, not caused during the war. And here we have three doctors all attending him. When was the last time you had three doctors together in the same room with you? So, and they would do this frequently. This one actually was typed. It was a little bit more recent. Goes through, he's applying for his increase. This was in 1907. He has a hernia and a rupture. He's had it for 4 years. His weight, his height. The sitting, standing, and after exercise pulse rates. Where else are you going to get that for one of your ancestors? So, scar on the left side of his forehead. And by the way, if your disability, I did point out another place, you couldn't have it by vicious habits. Anybody who incurred stuff by vicious habits, you don't get a pension, which means you drank a lot, you did drugs, you were slothful or whatever. That was one thing to watch out for. You didn't want the vicious habits. Okay, so now here, he's passed away, John's gone. Here's my great-great-aunt Barbara applying for the widow's pension. So she fills out a form, working again with an alderman or attorney. Like I say, there's a whole side economy spun up around this. So here's she applying, Barbara Fierce, she's 59. In the case of John Fierce, again, when he enlisted and when he died, May 1st, 1908. She was married under the name Barbara Meisner, maiden name, hey, to John Fierce. When were they married? Who married them? Neither had been previously married. Neither before or died afterwards. By this time, all the children were over 16, so that's why they just blanked that out. No prior application was done. There's the certificate he had, her post office address. Here's Thomas Fierce again, the brother. She brought the brother back again. And then brought this John Hogg with her. And they go through that the brother-in-law has known her for 43 years. John has known her for 10 years. There's their signatures to go through that, yes, she is who she says she is. Came up with a copy of the marriage certificate. It's a neat thing to have. This is actually a copy. It's not an original. But it's pointing out the assistant pastor is saying, yes, they were married. Here's where they were married. In the presence there of Bernard Meisner. That's not me. That's her brother, my original Bernard Meisner, as I call him. And the maid of honor. So there you've got relatives and friends of every other case. You're trying to find somebody and you just can't find them. One of the things you do is look for their friends or neighbors. And if you can find one of them, then maybe you can find, you start looking around and find the other. So if you couldn't find Barbara, if you look for Mary Strable, you might find Barbara nearby. You know, you sort of pick somebody as your maid of honor who you sort of know. Then she provides, she's applying as the widow, so she has to prove he's dead, right? So there was a death certificate. Here's some, again, supporting documents from Thomas Fierce and Joseph Meisner. Joseph is my great-grandfather, another brother. So we got all the brothers involved with this. They both knew the dead soldier and the applicant, Barbara, before either of them were marriageable age. And marriageable age, does that mean like 10? No, from personal knowledge, neither of them had married before. They were married to each other. They lived and cohabited together as man and wife. Even the one who was 18 when her husband was 81, right? Not this couple. From 1867 till he died, no divorce. She hasn't remarried. So that's all what they're stating in the affidavit. Again, some good information. And lo and behold, she was eligible, got her pension. There's the record. She got the certificate and did, in fact, get the pension. And here on the left is then 661936. That's the last certificate number. That's where you find the file, the widow's certificate. There's the application number. But again, everything got moved. And that's where I got all the information. I went and asked for that number of the record. Okay, again, we have some more of the information from her pension, no other service, when he died, when she filed the declaration, not remarried, wasn't divorced, when he filed his two applications. Okay, sometimes Nora doesn't have the record. Could be two things. One, you ask them to go into the files, look for the record, and they went and looked, and you got a young kid that just started to work at Dara, and he looks at the one place and can't find it, comes back and says, sorry. Maybe you want to submit again because you may find somebody who's a little bit more experienced, says, well, it's not right here. Well, you know, people miss file things. It's sort of look down the shelf a little bit this way, a little bit that way, and you may find it a second time. But again, there are cases where you won't find that. This is for, I was doing this for my cousin, his great-grandfather, Peter Lenihan. And there he's applied, then the widow applied. Again, this is the second wife, and he was sneaky. Both wives were Margaret's. So suddenly in the census, Margaret's age changed substantially, and we were scratching our heads until we finally figured out, oh, first Margaret died, second Margaret has appeared. So there's the number. He's applied there in 1907 due to age. And I get back this form, and they have checked number 14 of their standard responses. We ain't got the file. We think you should look for Veterans Affairs. And I was trying to think, this guy died in 1911. And he was on the second wife, and she's long dead. And I was thinking, why do the veterans have his file? It's been dead for so long. Dun, 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 dun. This is the form I filled out. I did all the little numbers. It came back. And until I was preparing this presentation for my society about a year ago and caught on to the C and XC numbers and then 1928 still active date, I didn't catch. They had written on the bottom, which I didn't see. You look at the forms when they send it back, the XC number. And she apparently was still alive around 1928. She's not shown up. I can't find her 1930 census. But she was around long enough collecting the pension that the records are still with the Veterans Administration. Again, there's only one pension person, that one woman, still collecting. So you kind of think, well, VA, wouldn't you want to sort of get rid of those records and maybe give them to NARA? And NARA, of course, would probably like to have them and get them all digitized. And apparently our negotiations are underway. But when that's going to occur. So again, what you do is you do your Freedom of Information Act. I have to convince my cousin to do this, to go through and say, could you please look for the file? And it may take up to a year for them to get around to do it and find it, wherever it may be. So you got to be very, very patient on those. Last thing to consider, how credible is the information? The government's giving away money and you want some of it. Are you willing to lie to get money? None of your ancestors would ever do that, right? So. I'm sure in the record somewhere there are some that aren't quite right. This is a case you saw again. This is when Barbara was applying the death certificate for John Fierst. And if we look at closely, she's the one giving the information about her husband. And they said, what was his father's name? And she said, Andrew J. Fierst. And what was his mother's name? Barbara Schenck. And I should point out, I didn't do it before, where she signed on her application, she just made her mark. Okay, so she couldn't write. She could potentially read, but maybe didn't write. And this sort of thing happened to me when my father died. He was in Pennsylvania, I was in California. I'd been up all night, and I'm talking to the funeral director, and he's asking me the information over the death certificate, and said, what was your father's mother's name? And she died when I was two. And I sort of went, I'm a genealogist. I should know this. Hang on, let me go look. So I think what happened in this case is I've done enough other research to know his parents were John Fierst and Margaret Zimmerman. But Barbara, his widow, filling out the form, well, you'll guess what her parents' names were? How about Andrew, probably Andrew J. Meisner, and Barbara Schenck? When they asked her who were the father and the mother, she heard who was your father and mother, and she said Andrew J. and Barbara, and I said, what's Barbara's last name? Schenck. And then they filled it out that way. So this was an honest mistake. But again, you're getting sort of secondhand information. So as genealogists, we're always careful. And this is not a case of somebody committing fraud trying to get the money from the government. So remember, they're applying because they want to get money. Some will give the information they know the best of their ability. Some will give the information they think will best get them the pension. So you have to weigh that evidence and be careful, don't extend errors going onward. So, you ready to go mining? Thank you.